Okay, this will be your last section test. It's due April 8th. None of the policies have changed. Missed assignment policies on there, the assignment submission policy, make sure I get it. Of course, plagiarism, don't do it. Finger wave, finger wave. This pertains to all of the Kierkegaard and Nietzsche readings and vi video material. I do ask you questions on the related to the Roderick video material, and my videos are going to frame a lot of these questions as well. Part one, five short answer questions, 2 points each, 10 points. Longer answer question asks you to interpret two passages. Hopefully, to the extent possible, with this sort of difficult to interpret material, it should be pretty straightforward. These are issues that we've raised, so it shouldn't really surprise you all that much. So, question one, despair is the sickness unto death. Roderick explains that this is not a mood problem. Why is this sort of existential despair not a mood problem? Part two of the question, Roderick identifies the first sort of not yet despair and uses the example of zombie movies to explain what it is. Discuss this sort of not yet despair. Total of 2 points. 1 point for the first part, 1 point for the second part. Engage Roderick and Kierkegaard really in the argument of why despair is not a mood problem, like why you can't go to a therapist and say, I'm in despair, fix it, right? Then engage with Roderick's zombie movie description. I do so in the video as well. That's your first question. Second question, Kierkegaard discusses two sorts of despair in the strict sense. That's from 351 Kierkegaard. They are not to will to be oneself and in despair to will to be oneself. Kierkegaard 351 again. Briefly discuss each, distinguishing between them. I do this in the video. Kierkegaard actually is bizarrely clear about these kinds of despair, which are structurally similar but not the same. I think I gave you the Tyler Durden example from Fight Club just to illustrate these two kinds of despair. It's bizarre how well Fight Club actually works with religious existentialism. It's until you start explaining it in those terms, you don't realize how well it works. But nonetheless, so those are those two kinds of questions. So give me a quick description of each and make the distinction between for those questions. Question three, in Twilight of the Idols. In section two of The Problem of Socrates, Nietzsche makes the following claim. One must, by all means, stretch out one's fingers and make an attempt to grasp this amazing finesse, that the value of life cannot be estimated. He goes on, not by the living because they're an interested party, and not by the dead for another reason. Right? This claim actually kind of frames Nietzsche's criticism of the judgment dispositions at the basis of most of what he wants to criticize. It's present in The Problem of Socrates, it's present in Reason and Philosophy, and it's present in Morality as Anti-Nature, right? So this is sort of a central claim for Nietzsche. I go over it in the video. That should be pretty straightforward, right? Just interpret this claim that the value of life cannot be estimated. Okay, question four. This is another Roderick question. Roderick, while discussing the paradox of interpretation raised by Nietzsche, claims that it's crucially important in the political economy of the university to deny Nietzsche's insight for this reason, if it is one. And he's talking about standards and education kind of thing. So in getting the right interpretation of a text, right? So it's basically what I want you to do is engage with Roderick's argument there. There's a transcript of that argument if you don't feel like rewatching the videos, though I find Roderick amusing. So that might be fun for you as well. So the idea is to briefly discuss this paradox of interpretation. Right, for with regard to Roderick's interpretation of the interpretation of Nietzsche that he's offering here. Right, so that's in the Roderick video. Then finally, in Twilight of the Idols, in the section called Morality as Anti-Nature, Nietzsche presents a rather damning criticism of Christian morality, claiming that this form of morality turns hostily against the passions or attempts to kill the passions. At one point, he compares it to castration. Right? Here, the alternative Nietzsche proposes is the spiritualization of passion. Portable Nietzsche, 487, for which he gives us two examples, love and hostility. Briefly discuss how Nietzsche uses these passions, love and hostility, as examples of triumph over the prevailing form of morality. Right? So, what does Nietzsche argue of love and hostility that illustrates his case for the spiritualization of the passions? Part one. Right? And part two, how does this represent some sort of an overcoming of the prevailing form of morality by Nietzsche's estimation? Right? Note that in any of these questions, I don't need you to agree with these theorists, I just need you to understand what they're saying in any of the shorter answer questions. Part two, longer answer question. Longer answer questions, minimum of three paragraphs in response, whereas 3 to 5 sentences minimally for the short answer questions. Note that I'm giving you minimums here too. Question. Kierkegaard begins Sickness Unto Death with the following passage, and it's that big ugly one. Human being is spirit, but what is spirit? Spirit is the self, but what is the self? The self is a relation that relates itself to itself, or is the relations relating itself to itself in the relation? The self is not the relation, but is the relations relating itself to itself? A human being is a synthesis of the infinite and the finite, the temporal and the eternal, of freedom and necessity, in short, a synthesis. A synthesis is a relation between two. Considered in this way, human being is still not a self. I give you a good analysis of that passage in my video. Also, evoking the notion of spirit, Nietzsche in Morality as Anti-Nature, as part of his discussion of the spiritualization of the passions, asserts our attitude to the internal enemy is no different. Here too we have spiritualized hostility. Here too we have come to appreciate its value. The price of fruitfulness is to be rich in internal opposition. One remains young only as long as the soul does not stretch itself and desire peace. Nothing has become more alien to us than that highly desired state of former times, peace of the soul, the Christian highly desirable state. There is nothing we envy less than the moralistic cow and the fat happiness of good conscience. One has renounced the great life when one renounces war. The Portable Nietzsche, 488 to 489. So, now, I've quoted both of the passages. Those will focus your analysis. Both Kierkegaard and Nietzsche clearly rely upon internal tensions in order to account for the passions and human subjectivity. They also clearly hold contradictory positions. For Kierkegaard, the tensions that constitute human life are sustained by faith in God. Nietzsche, on the other hand, rejects such a relationship with God in favor of passionate engagement with life. Your task is twofold. First, interpret these passages. Interpret them. Oh, what's Kierkegaard getting at here? What's Nietzsche getting at here? Second, illustrate the distinctions between these positions. So what's the difference between Kierkegaard and Nietzsche? All right. I will say, especially with this second part, this longer answer question, these theorists are more opaque than the other ones that we've been engaging with. Both of them actually engage with the problem of interpretation themselves actually being problematic to interpret, as I'm sure you've noticed. So, with regard to your interpretations of these positions, I'm going to be a bit easier, right, in terms of rigor, right, because they are difficult positions to think through. Now, what I am, however, looking for, though, is a substantial attempt to interpret these passages and to interpret the positions of both of these theorists, right? So I want to see a concerted effort on your part to engage with these theorists, right? So it's odd to say that this material should be pretty straightforward because it's difficult material. You see, what we've done is we've gone from the clear sort of training wheels philosophy through the history of Western philosophy to the more difficult, harder to interpret philosophy. There is a critical edge to both of these arguments, right? There is substance to both of these arguments, and both of these theorists are taken pretty seriously, right, in contemporary circles, right? So you're expected to engage and work hard at interpreting this material, but I'm acknowledging, reached the difficult point in the class, right, where you're relying on the skills that you've built throughout the class to bring your critical abilities to bear on these more hardy or tighter woven knots of argument. Right? So I look forward to reading your response, and have good days. Please contact me if you have questions. All right. Thanks.